bless you, dear viewer. Thank you so much for joining us on this segment of our ministry that we call Building Kingdom Wealth. In fact, we like referring it to it as Building Wealth the Kingdom Way. I got to tell you that there's something called building wealth, and there is something called building wealth the kingdom way. There's how to do things the kingdom way. Hallelujah. And so I want you to understand that this is a segment in which I will be divulging or giving over to you five books of my messages on wealth building. And the first unit is actually what we call the race against poverty. We are through with it, and you can be able to get into our bank, our wisdom bank, and be able to get into that school and have everything that we've talked about in that unit. And so we're in unit number two that we call opening your life to accommodate wealth. One of the reasons why a lot of people are not able to build wealth is basically because they don't have room for it. For you to truly be able to build anything in this life, you must have room for it. You'd be shocked to discover how many people have had marriage fail in their lives because they never had room for marriage. And that is true concerning God. That is true concerning the things of God, that there are so many people that have locked God out of their lives. We can lock the Holy Spirit out of our lives. We can lock redemption out of our lives. We can lock Christ out of our lives. And we can lock the gifts of the Holy Spirit of God and the power of God. We can lock the divine out of our lives. We can basically lack room for anything that God created for us, and that includes wealth. And that's the sad reality in this life, that there's so many people that never have room for wealth in their lives, and that's why they really can't be able to build wealth. In fact, you would be shocked to discover that some people are in the marketplace trying to just earn a living. They are very repulsive towards wealth. They're resistant towards wealth, but they are in the marketplace, and what they're doing in the marketplace is not to try to build wealth, but basically to try to make a living or survive. But I gotta tell you that there is a place where you go to the marketplace because you want to build wealth. For that to happen, you must have room in your life. You must build the capacity to up in your life for wealth in your life and accommodate it. And so I want you to understand that that's going to be very important. And in getting to open your life to accommodate wealth, one of the most important things is you must define wealth. So that's what I want to talk about today. You must define wealth accurately. Anything that is not accurately defined, you can struggle to build. Let me put it this way. Before you can build anything, you must first of all design it. But before you can design, you must define. That is the principle. I want you to get that in your spirit. Before you can build, you must design. But before you can design, you must define. If you don't have the accurate idea about what you want to build, you cannot design it correctly. And if you can't design it correctly, you cannot build it correctly. In other words, inability to define means inability to design, and inability to design means inability to build. That is the principle. So if you can't define marriage correctly, you cannot design it, and if you can't design it, you cannot build it. If you cannot define wealth correctly, you will struggle to design it correctly, and if you cannot design it, neither can you build it. That is the principle. So it is possible that somebody tries to design wealth and build wealth, but the definition is wrong. Wrong definition means wrong design, and wrong design means wrong building. So several people struggle in the marketplace because they are building something wrongly because they have designed it incorrectly. And incorrect design is basically caused by incorrect definition. I pray that that makes sense. And that's why today I want us to attempt to define wealth so that we have a clear idea about what God calls wealth. And the reason why this is important is because you find the word wealth in the Kingdom Manual, the Bible. When you go to the Holy Bible, you will find the word wealth several times. And so if God talks about it, It must have a meaning. And if it has a meaning, then it is important to understand it. Because if you don't understand it, it is possible to be lied to concerning wealth. And if somebody successfully lies to you concerning wealth, you might as well develop negative attitude, negative energy, and repel wealth, and get to a place where you reject wealth altogether, because your knowledge of wealth is negative. That's why it's important that you come to the place where you can clearly understand it. The first thing that I want to confront you with is that wealth is not money. I want us to settle that before we go any farther in this segment of this message today. That wealth is not money. Having a lot of money does not mean wealth. That is important. In fact, it is possible for a thief to have money. Is he wealthy? No, he's not wealthy. He's a thief who has money. It is possible for somebody poor to stumble into money and get some lottery and be able to have a lot of money. But is he wealthy? No, he's not wealthy. He's a poor person who has money. That is right. That's why you've known so many people that at one point had a lot of money, and then now they don't have it. They got to the place where they lost what they had because they were not wealthy. They just were poor people who had money. So you must understand that wealth is not money, and money is not wealth. That is important. So in your quest to build wealth, therefore, never allow money to become the central pursuit. You must understand what wealth is. And when you focus on building wealth, then money will come forth. So one of the most important things that you must understand is that, yes, money can be a product of wealth. And when money is a product of wealth, then it is positive product. And when you have that positive money that is positive product, then it always channels positivity into your life. Now let me explain a little bit further so that we can be able to have understanding. You understand that when God created man, God didn't create money. You need to understand that money was never created by God. Money was actually created by needs. If you look in the scripture, you discover that when God created man, there was no money. God created man and gave him divine provision. There was no need in the Garden of Eden anywhere. And tragedy struck when man sinned. The Bible said that God drove him from the Garden of Eden, and he drove him to the place where he had been formed from. In chapter number 3 of the book of Genesis, in number 17 to 19, then suddenly we find man is confronted by needs. In the Garden of Eden, there was no need at all. But now in the place of the fall, man is confronted by needs. And God spoke this word. He said, casteth the ground because of you. He said, through painful toil you will eat from it, and it will bring forth thorns and thistles. And he said, by the sweat of thy brow will you eat from the ground, until you go to the dust, because dust you are, and to dust you will return. And so God talks about a man who has been thrown from the platform where there was divine provision, and now has come to the place where poverty confronts him. So he has to get to plow and labor on the soil to get the produce of the soil, because needs have confronted him. And so over a period of time, humanity traded on their potential, in the sense that people would get to produce what their potential had the capacity to produce. So somebody else, was a farmer and he went for the produce of the field. Somebody else was a counselor who could be able to help marriages work. Somebody else is a midwife who can actually help women get to give birth and stuff like that. So you use your potential to get to bring forth services to community. And in exchange for your potential, you actually get products coming from the products of somebody else's potential. I pray that you understand that. And that was called barter trading. And in the course of time, humanity came to the place where they saw it necessary to get a common medium of exchange that then was called money, so that now you can not only buy what you need, but you can also buy more of what you can produce so that you can have abundance. That's exactly how money came in. Money came in as a force, an instrument that we trade with, a medium of exchange through which we actually get to execute our buying power. That's how money came into being. I want you to get it. And so since that time, money is a product. Money can be a product of wealth. Money can be a product of wealth. In other words, it is possible that what we call wealth, which is actually capacity, it is dominion, it is a force, it is a power. In fact, you need to get that in your spirit. Wealth is a force. That's the definition in the Bible. If you go to the book of Genesis, chapter number 34, and verse number 29, you see the word wealth for the first time, and you actually see it translated from the Hebrew word that means a force. Wealth is a force. Hallelujah. When wealth is a force, then money becomes a positive product of this force. That's why money is called currency, from the word current, which is actually a force. So you can have positive force coming from the force that is called wealth, the capacity that's called wealth, which we'll talk about much more deeply later. And that product that is money coming from wealth then is positive force, and it brings positivity to man's life. That's why in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 10, verse number 16, then God says, the wages of the righteous bring them life. In other words, if you use the capacity that we call wealth, the positive force that we call wealth, and you produce money, then that will cause, it will channel life. It will become a channel of life. So the wages of the righteous bring them life. Hallelujah. It brings life to you. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter number 7, and verse number 12, the Bible says that money is a shelter. In other words, money can become a shelter. By the power of money, you can be able to house your family in a beautiful estate where there's very good security. It does not so much attract the security that is divine, but there's human security that wealth can give you the power to get to execute over your family and over your children. Hallelujah. And so money is a shelter. Money is a shelter. He goes on, he says, as wisdom is a shelter. But chapter number 10 and verse number 19, the scripture says, money answers all things. So money can be positive force if it is a product of wealth. The problem is that money is not always a product of wealth. That's why even in the financial market, you actually discover there's also false currency, fake currency, because it's supposed to be produced by negative forces. In other words, it is possible that the money that somebody has come from negative power. If you look in the scripture, God speaks these words in the book of Deuteronomy 8 and verse number 18. It says that he gives you the power to make wealth. He gives you the power to produce the products of wealth. God gives you the power. When we go to the marketplace, God can give us the power to make wealth. And when we make wealth in that way, we can actually produce money that is positive, that is a product of the power God gave to us. But I got to tell you this. It is possible for somebody to turn to satanic power to make money. That is right. It is possible for somebody to go to a witch doctor to win clients in the marketplace. It is possible for somebody to go to astrology, go to diviners, and get to read the signs in the heavens and stuff like that, and get to interact with the heavenly bodies and have stars and look at the movement of the stars to be able to give you direction on how to make money. And at the end of the day, then you've actually used a force, you've used a spiritual power, but it's not the power of God. And so because the power that you've used to produce money is negative power, therefore the product too is negative product. I'm going to talk about that in a short while. It is also possible, of course, for money to be a product of negative process. When you don't have understanding of what wealth is, you can turn to negative power to make money. When you don't understand what wealth is, you can turn to negative process. You can get into a process. That's why people have killed their brother to get what their father left. People have gotten involved in things, processes that were so negative that eventually yielded money, but that money was actually a product of a negative process. Such money does not bring life. It brings destruction. That's why in Proverbs 10, verse number 16, the first line we've just seen, God says that the wages of the righteous brings them life. The wages of the righteous bring them life. I pray that you are the kind of righteous person that the process through which you're making money is righteous process. It is right process. It's clean process. And if that is you, then the wages you get, the products of that process, should bring you life. And I pray that whatever you get channels life into your life. But the next line in that chapter of scripture is sad. It says this. It says, but the income of the wicked brings them punishment. In other words, you can get income, but that income becomes a channel of punishment. Now, punishment is evil. It's misfortunate happening. It is evil occurring in your life. And that can happen to somebody if you turn to negative process. And several times, you turn to negative process to make money because you don't understand what wealth is. That's why you got to define wealth correctly. If you look at chapter number 13 of the book of Proverbs and verse number 11, the first line is very interesting. God says, dishonest money dwindles away. In other words, what God calls dishonest money is money that you have, but it's a product of dishonest process. It's possible that somebody has a lot of money in your account, a lot of money in your life, but that money, heaven looks at that money as dishonest money. And the reason is because it is the product of dishonest process. And as long as it's a product of dishonest process, the Bible says that it always dwindles away. It attracts forces that will scatter it. It attracts forces that will make you lose it. And that's why there are people that have had money before, but they're no longer here. There are companies that used to be great companies, but they're no longer there. And the reason is simple. Over the years, people got involved in dishonest process to make money in the companies. And at the end of the day, then it dwindled away because dishonest money dwindles away. Proverbs 21 number 6, this is what it says. It says, a fortune gained by a lying tongue is a fleeting vapor and a deadly snare. It is possible that your finances, which are a fortune, but they're gained by a lying tongue. And God says that they become a fleeting vapor and deadly snare. I want you to see those two forces. The money that you have becomes a fleeting vapor. In other words, it evaporates. It fleets. It flies away. It evaporates. It disappears from you. It will always attract forces that will make it evaporate and leave you because it's a fleeting vapor. But that's not it. It's also a deadly snare. In other words, it's a snare of death. It's a snare of destruction. So it's possible that right now somebody has money and that money has become a trap of destruction. It's a snare of destruction. And that's why you find yourself taking the next step and it's a wrong step until eventually the law catches up with you and you are locked up in jail. So money has become a snare of destruction. Some people have been killed because of the money they had, and several times basically because that money was a snare of destruction. That's why you must be careful how you make your money. You have to be careful how you make your money because the negative process will produce negative money that will have negative power. Jeremiah chapter number 17, verse number 11 says, like a partridge that hatches eggs, it did not lay. It's the man who gains riches by unjust means. I wanted to see again somebody gaining riches by unjust means. I want to see the next word. God says that when his life is half gone, it will desert him. In other words, when he reaches middle age, he will have middle age crisis, and this time the middle age crisis is caused by the departure of the money that you had. And that's why there are people that in the first half of their lives had a lot of money, and the second half of their life they are living in poverty. And if you wind the clock backwards, you realize they just got this through misfortunate and very dishonest processes. Negative process will always cause negative money. Negative money has negative consequence. James chapter number 5 and verse number 1 to 4 is alarming. It's one of the most painful scriptures to read. It says, listen, you rich people. It said, weep and wail because of the misery coming upon you. It said, your gold has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. He said, your gold and your silver are corroded, and their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. God talks about a painful experience that somebody's going to go through that is comparable to your flesh being eaten like fire. Hallelujah. But the reason why God said that is because of verse number 4. It says, the wages you did not pay the workmen who mowed your fields are testifying against you. In other words, God is saying, you have made money, but you've made money by oppressing somebody else. So the money that you have is a product of oppression. You employed a house help you never paid. And you decided to use the money you could have used to pay this slave girl, this servant girl, and you are trying to use that money to build something, and that money becomes a channel of evil force that will eat your flesh like a fire. That is not Old Testament, that's New Testament. And when you see it in the New Testament, you better pay attention. Hallelujah. God says that it is possible to have negative product, money that is negative product that channels a force that eats up your flesh. I pray that you get it. If you don't understand what wealth is, it is still possible to turn to fantasies and luck. It is possible to turn to luck as a means of getting money. That is also spoken about in the Bible. Now, I want you to understand this, that there is a difference between having predictive ability to produce wealth with. We're going to talk about that. Because humanity has different capacities. We have different instruments for building wealth. And one of the instruments that God's given to us is predictive ability. We have ability to predict. If you are participating in the marketplace, you will always understand that your ability to predict market opportunities and market dynamics will actually give you the power to be ahead of everybody and make wealth. So we have the power of prediction. Please understand, the power of prediction is completely different from lottery, that the gambling that we do in casinos and stuff like that, where people basically wait for fantasies, they're waiting for luck. God talks about people that are looking to luck and fantasizing about how they will be able, if they get lucky, they will get this amount of money. God talks about such people, and he talks about how poverty is going to come upon them. If you look at Proverbs chapter number 28, verse number 19, it says, he who farms his land, he who works his land, will have abundant food. In other words, if you work your land, you will have abundant food. But it says, but he who chases after fantasies will have his fill of poverty. Chasing after fantasies is getting to the place where you're depending on luck. You were never created to live on luck. We are people that are created to live on the blessing of God, which is the power to prosper. And I pray that you get it. But if you don't understand wealth, then it is possible for you to turn to luck, turn to fantasies as a means of waiting and hoping for some kind of money to just come upon your life without you getting to cause it. I pray that that's not going to be you. So, if wealth is not money, then the question that begs is then, what is wealth? Because that is important. If you truly get to understand what wealth is, then that will help you define it correctly so you can design it correctly so you can get to build it. But for now, I want to leave you there. I just want you to get to the place where you understand that there's positive money, there's negative money. That money that is positive channels good into your life. And it's possible to have negative money. And the question that I want to ask you is, what is the money that you have? Is it positive money? Is it negative money? It's times it's possible that you have money that is a product of theft. So you look at the scripture, God talks about people that steal from him. In the book of Malachi chapter number 3, God talks about people that don't tithe. And he says, you rob me. So you ask, how do we rob you? So then tithes and offerings. So it's possible that you have withheld what is due to God, the God who gave you life, the God who gave you power, the God who determines whether you're going to live the next moment or not. And you get to rob him by getting to withhold what is God's. And that in itself then attracts evil. You need to get to the place where your finances are reconciled to God before I get to talk about what is wealth. Is your money reconciled to God? Before we get to talk about tithing, is your money reconciled to God? Have you come to the place where you know that what is left in your account is reconciled to God? It is money that is insured. It is money over which the blessing of God is. It is money that is truly a seed that will cause great harvest when you put it in the soil because it's blessed of God. Are you that kind of person that is walking with God financially? Or are you somebody that's trying to build wealth on your own strength? I gotta tell you, in the kingdom, it does not work. There's formula on every kingdom platform. That's why every government in every kingdom has a constitution. The constitution just says, when you live on this platform, this is how you must do things for you to see yourself prosper and go to the next level. I want to stop there, because if I go to the next phase, I'm gonna take so many of your hours. God bless you as you continue to listen. We're going to be coming to you every week. But if you want to get the full message and all the messages in the segments, please get yourself registered and go to that link. And God is going to help you as we'll follow one session after another. Something is going to be building in your life. And before long, you'll find yourself participating in the marketplace and building great wealth for the glory of God. I want to pray for you who want to support this work. If this has blessed you in this ministry, we never have any compulsion for anybody. We just love to make sure that everybody that gives cheerfully and gives with a willing heart. That is the heart of God. And so when I'm asking you to give, it's never in any way to compel anybody that just because you've listened to this sermon, then you have to give. No, we don't do that. We're giving you a chance, you who want to give. And that's why I want to pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you for everybody listening to me. As we're coming to this segment of building wealth the kingdom way, then walking with you through our givings will also be important. And that's why it is important that everybody listening to me then gets to give. I pray, Father, for your favor, for your blessing to come upon the lives of your people as we tithe and as we give of our offerings and our free will offerings and our support. May your glory come upon the lives of your people and grant us, our Father, that every money in our lives is reconciled to God. But there's no evil force our money can attract because of any negative process. I bless your people in Jesus' mighty name. If you want to give your life to Christ, this really has to be from the heart. Again, this is not by compulsion, but I got to tell you, you live at a time that you need God. That really is the reality. If you look at what's going on right now in the world, beloved, whoever you are, everybody needs the backing up of God Almighty, divine backup. Everybody listening to me right now needs backup. You need divine security. You need divine health, beloved. You live in a world where right now I heard on the international media that what is called Corona has 1,700 variants. That means that as we're trying to do vaccination, it's actually mutating and getting to camouflage into different strains. What is it? What is that talking to us? Just telling you that humanly, without God, we may struggle. And so everybody needs God. While we're taking all the human measures, and please understand me, there is the human responsibility that you need to take. You need to mask and do all of those kind of things. It's very important. But at the end of the day, the reality is you need the divine power of God to stay healthy all your life. You need God. And so if you want to do that, if you want to give your life to Christ, if you want to rededicate your life to Christ, why don't you pray this prayer with me? Just say, Lord Jesus, I come to you. I acknowledge that I need you in my life. And I give you my life today. I ask you to forgive me for every sin and come into my life. Save my soul, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've done that, very simple prayer, done from the heart. This is the kind of prayer you pray not with your mouth, but with the heart. If you prayed it with the heart, you've just given your life to Christ. God sees the heart. And if you prayed that kind of prayer with the heart, God knows. And you've just given your life to Christ, you've gotten born again. And God is seeking of you to reach out and see how you can grow. You must be part of a congregation. And if you are within our proximity, we would ask you to find a way to locate us so that we can be able to grow you in the kingdom of God and bring you to the place of your divine destiny in God Almighty. If you're far away from us, we would still love to hear you call us. Our numbers are right there. Get to communicate. We want to know that you got saved through this link and through this line. And we will give you counsel, give you advice on how you can be able to grow in the Lord. May God bless you so much. We love you. We'll see you again next week. Kenny Afer is my name. And I love you very much. Amen.